Hey, I'm Dave. Welcome to my shop. Today in Dave's Garage, we're going to look at building a real live project that combines software, electronics, and mechanics. Building a dynamic third brake light LED system for my classic 1970 GMC pickup truck. This system will connect to the factory trailer connector and control an otherwise hidden LED strip below the tailgate. We'll use an ESP32 dual-core processor to run the system and power it with a 5-volt buck converter tied into the truck's electrical power. I'll show you how to interface with the signals and brakes, which will give us a very visible set of sequential taillights, a strobing brake light, an intensely bright backup light, hazard mode, and even a multicolor emergency mode for police and fire vehicles. Let's take a quick peek at what the system actually looks like. First, we have the standard signal. It's triggered by the voltage sent to the factory bulb, and so will always be perfectly timed to align with it. The animation restarts every time the factory bulb flashes, so they maintain the same flash rate as well. The brake light comes on immediately in the center and expands from there while also doing an initial strobe. It's tied into the factory brake lights and operates in conjunction with the high mount center stop lamp that I also added. The hazards are triggered when both brake lights are seen pulsing and incorporates both the strobe and the expansion effects for maximum visibility, which is of course highly desirable if you're parked or broken down in a hazardous location. When it comes time to back up, the entire strip illuminates in full bright white. This is the most demanding part of the project electrically, as it takes anywhere from 45 to 75 watts depending on how wide your strip is. There's also the emergency vehicle mode, which I think would be very handy for police undercover vehicles that do not have a full light bar. I don't even wire this feature in when it's in my own vehicle, as I don't want it ever triggering for any reason whatsoever, but it's fun to hotwire and demo it inside the garage. Even though it's been an entertaining and rewarding project to work on, I did undertake this project out of a genuine need. Put simply, I really do not want to get rear-ended in this truck for several reasons, not the least of which being that I spent about 5 years restoring this truck by hand right here in this shop. I bought the truck from the estate of the original owner down in California, who originally purchased the truck way back in 1969 so that he and his family could tour the nation with a camper attached. And tour they did for about 40 years, until the owner ultimately passed away a few years ago. In doing my research, I located the owner's grandchildren, who in turn shared a few of their stories of the adventures in the truck, the details of the truck's history, such as the phone intercom that Grandpa used to communicate with the camper, and even these photos taken when it was delivered to their grandparents brand new over 50 years ago. When I was a kid growing up in the winters of Saskatchewan, our daily family vehicle had been my dad's 68 GMC pickup, and so I too wanted a GMC for nostalgic reasons. Unlike my dad's ultra basic work truck, however, I wanted a highly optioned unit. Now, like a lot of people who set out to find and restore one of these trucks, I was originally searching for a short bed example with air conditioning and ideally a big block engine. That would mean I was looking for a Sierra Grande with a custom camper trim package option, the highest trim level. When I found this example, it ticked all the boxes except it was a seriously heavy duty unit. Rather than being a short box, it was even a Longhorn with an additional 9-inch bed extension to accommodate the very biggest slide-in campers of the day. Designated as a 3/4 ton but with a 1-ton chassis, it was so original and unmolested that I simply fell in love with it. When I took it apart, I didn't even need an impact tool to take the suspension apart, as there was zero rust even underneath. Everything came apart with simple hand tools. Wherever it lived down in California seemed to have an abundance of red dirt, however. My guess from Wikipedia is the San Joaquin Valley, but I don't really know. If you know, let me know in the comments. Pretty soon I embraced the heavy-duty theme and came to really appreciate the 1-ton frame, the big 8-lug wheels, and so on. In terms of options, it has almost everything available at the time. Bucket seats, air conditioning, tach, tilt, and the big block engine. Trucks in those days were almost always work vehicles, not the luxury family rollers that we've come to know and love today. That means most were very Spartan, and finding one like this with a lot of options is actually quite rare. Some things like cruise control, power windows, and power seats, however, were not even offered as options. As far as getting rear-ended is concerned, these trucks have tiny and dim 26-watt incandescent brake lights, one per side, and no center brake light at all, since those weren't introduced until sometime in the mid-1980s. They also completely lack any form of headrest, which means if and when you do get hit, your head bounces off of, or worse, maybe goes through, the back glass. Over the years, my dad was rear-ended in his, as was my neighbor as well, and both received whiplash injuries and minor head trauma from this sketchy setup. My first solution was to integrate a super bright red LED module into what is technically the bed lamp. I tied it into the brake pedal circuit so that when I hit the brakes, the bed lamp lights up bright red. By the way, the proper name for the third brake light is the center high mounted stop lamp. If you're ever looking for the fuse or trying to read a circuit diagram that includes it, it'll be labeled with the acronym CHIMSL, C-H-M-S-L, as a result. I was considering adding a strobe circuit to the new stop lamp, but the signals in this truck are even weaker than the brake lights, so I wanted to address them somehow as well. They operate by simply winking the brake light off and on that side. Ideally, I wanted to incorporate European-style amber turn lamps somehow, and that's what set me off down the path of adding the multicolor LED strip. Of course, with this much time invested in restoring the truck to its original appearance, the LEDs would have to be hidden unless active. I first looked at what was available on Amazon, and the only thing I could find that even offered sequential amber lights was about $100. Unfortunately, the widest version I could find for it was only 60 inches long, and my truck is about 80 inches wide, so I'd leave a fair gap. I was confident I could build my own for less and make it behave exactly as I wanted and have some fun doing it. I could also graft as many WS2812B strips together as I needed to get whatever length I wanted exactly. And for once, a crazy LED project of mine would actually serve a practical purpose, so how could I not do it? The first thing we need then are LEDs. My go-to LED strip is almost always the waterproof WS2812B from BTF Lighting. It runs on 5 volts, as does the ESP32 board itself, so clearly, we're going to need to come up with some way to supply 5 volts that can not only run the microcontroller, but that can also power the entire LED strip. If there are going to be ballpark 300 LEDs, and each one can consume about 50 milliamps max, that means we need about 15 amps of current, which at 5 volts means a maximum of 75 watts. That's a substantial buck converter, but I happen to have a few 75 watt examples on hand. For maximum brightness and continuity, we'll be using the highest pixel density strips at 144 pixels per meter. You can also get them down to 60 and even 30 pixels per meter at a much reduced cost, but they don't look like a solid line and they're nowhere near as bright. At the time I built the original, the 5 volt strips were about all that was available in the 144 LEDs per meter format, but today it looks like you can now buy WS2815B strips that natively accept 12 volts. You'd still need a source of 5 volt power for the ESP32 chip, but it would be very small and the LEDs themselves could be powered directly off the vehicle. You'd want to check the datasheet, as auto power isn't very stable, but if it's in the range, using the higher power strips could save you the voltage conversion on the largest part of the load. Either way, we're going to need 3 things at a minimum: ground, 12 volt power from the truck, and some way to interface with the truck's signals so that we know when the truck is turning or stopping. All of this is available at the truck's trailer connector. Most trucks today, and even many cars, are already pre-wired for a trailer. Sometimes the wiring is just bundled up underneath the bumper rather than nicely exposed in a plug as it usually is with a truck. Regardless, the problem is that there are many different formats of trailer connectors, such as the 4, 5, 6, and 7 pin setups, and that's just here in North America. There are also ISO standards for up to as many as 15 pins. I think we should assume what I believe is the most common case on a truck, the 7-pin trailer plug. That means we only have the most basic signals: taillights, left turn, right turn, backup, power, and ground. That's it. Even the brake signal is not active unless the vehicle has an electronic brake controller added or comes with it from the factory, but neither is always true. You can also do it with a 5-pin if you're willing to source power separately, and in fact with a 4-pin if you can forego the backup feature. Worst case, a suitably experienced tech could also interface with most older vehicles by tapping directly into the taillight wiring. Now, if there's no brake pin, how do we know when the vehicle is stopping? To solve this, we monitor the left and right turn pins. If they both go on within a small time window, we know the user is hitting the brakes, because in older vehicles, the brake lighting is really nothing more than both signal lights turned on at the same time. The simpler but incorrect solution would be to assume that braking is whenever both signal lights are active, but that's not true, unfortunately. Why? Because you can be braking and signaling at the same time. When you're doing so, both lights start on, but then the turning side will flash off and on. For example, let's say you hit the brakes and come to a stop. We see both left and right signals active because the brake is depressed and we would correctly start the brake strobe animation. But then the driver signals left, which starts to signal the left turn cycle. If we relied on both signals being high to indicate braking, we'd turn off the brake light as soon as the signal blinked off, and we'd restart the animation every time it came back on. That's why we need the extra bit of logic to latch the brake state on only when both left and right lights come on at the same time or near to it. I'm actually accounting for the possibility of 2 contacts mechanically, and that's why I'm not assuming that they come on at exactly the same time. So, we turn it off as soon as both signal pins go back low again. but not until both are low again. While it's great that we have these signals we can rely on, how do we connect them to the ESP32 chip, though? After all, they're a 12-volt connection, and the ESP32 expects no more than 3.3 volts on an input line. I wondered for a bit if it could be done with a voltage divider, and maybe it can, but I also wanted to have some isolation between the truck's higher power signals and our little chip. The voltage in a car's circuit can range from 12 volts to nearly 15 volts at times, and it can also be quite noisy. To solve this, I used a 12-volt relay board with 5 relays on it. The way it works is that when a signal from the truck's 12-volt system comes in, that signal is used to close a relay that is capable of accepting just such a 12-volt trigger. The 12 volts is used to energize a magnetic coil in the relay, which closes the switch, and that allows current to flow from the ESP32 back into one of its own input pins. And so that way, the ESP32 is ever only reading its own voltage. The truck opens and closes the relay switches, but the power from the truck is never routed directly into a signal line on the chip. I next built a version using optocouplers that worked equally well. An optocoupler is an incredibly simple but useful device. It's basically two pairs of pins, one connected to an internal LED. You can't see it, it's all inside the chip itself. The other is connected to an internal light sensor. When you turn on one set of pins, it turns on that internal LED and that immediately triggers the light sensor, which lets the current flow between the other pins. Long story short, it's a switch you can turn off and on by the absence or presence of power on the input side. When the 12-volt signal comes in from the left turn signal, for example, it activates the left turn pin on the chip, just as the relay would, but without the mechanical complications of a magnetic coil and switch. Since the relay version is actually what's installed in the truck, that's the version I'll be featuring here today, but if you're building one for yourself, the choice is yours. On a brand new one, I'd lean towards the optocoupler because it doesn't have any moving parts and should in theory be more reliable. And it turns out that many relay boards I've seen also isolate their triggers with optocouplers anyway, so at that point, the relay is actually a bit redundant and truly only needed for higher power applications than switching your own inputs. But hey, I'm a software guy and I didn't know any better, so this is how I built my first one. Now would likely be a good time to show you the system as a whole so that you can form an overview in your head as to how it all works. The system is composed of 5 major components. First, there's the trailer connector. This is where we pick up the lines for left turn, right turn, backup, 12-volt power, and ground. We feed those 12 volts into a 75-watt DC buck converter that produces 5 volts for us. We use that 5 volts to power both the computer circuit and the LED strip itself. Moving on, we have the relay board, which contains 4 12-volt relays. I may have said 5 earlier, but this board actually only has 4. In each case, when their 12-volt trigger line is hot, such as when the left turn signal goes on, they will close a relay on this board, which has the same effect as pressing the contact button on a logic board. The logic board contains those push-button switches for manually triggering each of the circuits for testing, as well as the ESP32 module itself. That module, in turn, contains a little 320 by 240 TFT display that indicates the current state of the system, such as which signal lines are active. It's really only for development and debugging, but I like it, so I kept it. Finally, the LED strip itself has a 3-wire connection. 15 amps of 5-volt power and ground from the buck converter, plus a data wire from an output pin on the ESP32 CPU. That data wire contains the square wave signal generated by the chip that controls the colors of each of the LEDs. For a typical size strip of 2 meters, it can be updated at least 100 times per second. Next, I'll take you on a brief tour of the software code that runs the show. Now don't worry, I won't spend too much time or get in too deep, and you might find it a gentle introduction to how microcontroller projects are normally set up. If you have any familiarity with C, it might help you to know that everything starts in main.cpp, where you supply 2 functions, setup and loop. On an ESP32 project, at its most basic, code is broken up into those 2 major sections, setup and loop. The setup code is called one time when the chip boots, and it's where you define one time things such as what pins do what. After setup is complete, loop is called repeatedly for as long as the chip continues to run. Our loop code will check the input signals, update the state of the lights, and draw whatever signal or breaking effect is required by the situation. Looking at the setup code, there are 2 points of interest. The first is where 4 pins are set to be inputs and are told to use their internal pull-down resistors. There's one for left turn, one for right turn, one for backup, and one for emergency lights. Recall that these will be fed a high signal from the 3.3 volt bus whenever the corresponding circuit on the truck is energized. Next, for each of those pins, we request that the CPU attach an interrupt, such that if any of those pins change state, our interrupt handler is then called. For example, Every time the state of the left turn bulb changes, whether turning from off to on or on to off, the left turn IRQ function will be called under interrupt each and every time. An interrupt means that the CPU will immediately stop whatever it is doing, push all of its state onto the stack, and immediately then call the left turn IRQ function every time that switch changes state. It happens immediately, without delay, as long as interrupts are not explicitly disabled somehow. The purpose of all this is to debounce the switches. You don't want to accept a new input state, like the switch going from off to on, unless the new input state has been stable for a minimum of about 30 milliseconds. Otherwise, imagine watching the switch close under a microscope in super slow motion. The switch will actually bounce open and closed a few times before it settles. With a fast CPU, if you're monitoring the switch, you'd actually see each of those as an off and on transition. Worse, it's random, so if you were to press the key on your keyboard and it worked like that, it might close once or three times or seven times, depending on how hard you hit it. This was a very real bug in the very first release of the 4K TRS-80 Model 1 Level 1, which I happen to own. The first thing you learned to do upon booting was to load a special keyboard debounce program from the cassette to make the machine actually usable. It's such a basic thing that I've always been surprised they shipped it that way, and the story of how and why they did so is one I'd love to hear, but not one that I've been able to talk to any Tandy engineers that seem to know. If you do know the story, let me know in the comments. Once the chip is set up, our loop code really just calls process and display inputs over and over. That code in turn gives each button a chance at processing the current inputs by calling its check for button press function. Next, we see some special logic that is monitoring the left and right turn signals. This is required because, as noted earlier, there's no brake signal available on the connector. With a simple utility or boat trailer, each side's brake light is controlled separately and braking is handled by lighting up both at once. Signaling is then handled by turning one of the lights off and on. By the way, if the tail lights are also on, that's actually handled by a separate filament in the lamp, and so our hardware circuit ignores them entirely. If the brakes are hit while signaling, both lamps come on at once, and then one starts blinking to indicate the turn in that direction. So we can't merely rely on looking at whether both left and right signals are on as an indication of braking. We also have to make sure that they came on at more or less the same time. I defined more or less as 30 to 50 milliseconds in the code, depending on which version I'm looking at. We then keep the braking effect active until both the left and right turn lines go inactive. That means the driver is lifted off the brake, so we end the effect. Once the code has considered all the inputs and updated what effects are active, each effect is then given its opportunity to draw the LED strip, and then the strip is rendered and turned on. I'd guess that maybe a quarter of the audience might appreciate a lot more detail on the code, and so if this video makes it to like 100k views, I'll do that code review episode of the entire code base and then stick it up on GitHub. How do you make that happen? Like it? Share it? Tell a friend? The basics. Because they work. After all, if each of you told only 10 friends within 10 generations, that would be 10 billion people. Is that too much to ask? Now, of course, the best thing you can do to support the channel if you're not already subscribed is to please make sure that you do so. Turn on the bell icon and personal recommendations as well so you'll get notice of each week's new episode. Thanks for joining me out here in the shop today. In the meantime and in between time, I hope to see you next time, right here in Dave's Garage. Thanks for joining me out here in the shop. In the meantime and in between time, I hope to see you next time. Ah, how can you screw up your own closer? How can you do it?